Fair Isle. Beautiful, isolated and mysterious, Fair Isle, only 3 miles by 1.5 miles, rises from the sea midway between Orkney and Shetland. It is an island of contrasts, the northern end heathery moorland bounded by steep jagged cliffs plunging down to the sea, the southern end a patchwork blanket of green fields and cultivated riggs. The Vikings called it Frithery, meaning peaceful or truce island, but today the name Fair Isle speaks for itself. Home of world-famous patterns and knitwear, it is a designated national scenic area and a bird monitoring station of international significance. Now owned by the National Trust for Scotland, the isle has been awarded the Council of Europe diploma as a place of outstanding natural beauty and cultural heritage. To get to Fair Isle, there is a choice of a 2.5 hour journey from Grutness, near Sombre Airport, on the ferry Good Shepherd 4. Or, for those who prefer flying, a 25 minute hop from Tingwall on a Loganair 8-seater Islander. The weather is fine. You are booked on the afternoon flight from Tingwall, and despite a bit of a headwind, you arrive at Fair Isle on schedule. After a smooth landing and the retrieval of your luggage, your eye falls on the plaque displayed on the terminal building, informing the visitor of the European Diploma Award. Not bad for a start. You have to begin a journey somewhere. This one begins at Sheep Craig, a prominent landmark on the east side of the isle, 135 metres high and linked to the island by a low impassable isthmus. The 10-acre area on its summit was used as grazing for sheep until 1977, the animals being hoisted on ropes from boats below, and lambs and fleeces lowered in the same way. The chain, used on the last 30 metres of the climb for the humans involved, was always said to be tested by the first man up. 400 years ago, before the land bridge had fallen away, cattle were kept on the Craig. Here is your first glimpse of the massive colonies of seabirds nesting in the cliffs. 100,000 pairs. Guillemots, razorbills, kittiwakes, fulmars, shags, puffins. Looking north, you can see the North Haven, and in the distance, Sombre Head and the south coast of the Shetland Mainland. The land slopes down to the northeast, and following the course of the Gilsiter Burn to the beach at Funnyhwy, it is possible to trace the line of click mills used in the past to grind oats and bear. Three of these stone-built, horizontal-wheeled water mills are clearly identifiable, and the only tirrell, or wheel, still in place, shows angled recesses for 12 paddles, although none have survived. Thank you. Heading northeast, you reach the top of the bone-shaped peninsula of Bunas. The name stems from the Norn Bú, meaning a farmstead, and Ness, headland. It is an area rich in prehistory. Today, it is the summer residence of a colony of Arctic terns, and among the flowers, parades of pompous puffins observe you placidly. Bunas is also a good vantage point for viewing the Good Shepherd's arrival. The boat carries passengers, mail and supplies, and as it comes alongside the deep water pier in the North Haven, cars, lorries and islanders wait to receive visitors and cargo. With a carrying capacity of more than 25 tonnes and a crane capable of a 2-tonne lift, the Good Shepherd can handle almost all island imports and exports. Passenger accommodation is comfortable, with toilet facilities and reclining seats with seat belts, a must for safety in bad weather. There is no safe natural harbour on the island, and although visiting and island boats can tie up in the shelter of the breakwater at the Haven during the summer, boats must be hauled up onto dry land before winter storms begin. A giant noost, or dry berth, was blasted out of the site of Bunas and a new slipway installed in order to house the Good Shepherd safely. The next step of this journey is to the famous Bird Observatory. But before going any further, a few words about George Waterston, a dedicated ornithologist who visited the isle in 1935 and conceived the idea of a bird study centre and hostel for visitors. After the war, he bought Fair Isle, and by the time the National Trust for Scotland took over in 1954, his dream had become a reality. Why is Fair Isle so special for the ornithologist? The island is situated in a most suitable geographical position for studying bird migration. It acts as a kind of stepping stone between Orkney and Shetland, and you get a concentration of birds here which you don't get anywhere else on the mainland. Now let's follow Roger Riddington, the observatory warden, and his assistants as they patrol the large wire netting funnel bird traps, a type developed at the Heligoland migration station more than half a century ago. The bird is encouraged to make its way to the point of no return. From there it can be rescued and taken back to the nearby laboratory for scrutiny. Once caught, the bird is examined in the hand in as much detail as may be necessary to confirm its identification, its age, and whether it be male or female. It is then measured and weighed to get some indication of how far the bird has travelled. This one is a chiffchaff, a regular spring and autumn migrant. wintering in Africa, its weight is 7.04 grams, requiring the use of the smallest aluminium ring available. The next bird caught is a meadow pipit. This species breeds on Fair Isle and winters in the UK and Southern Europe. And this one weighs in at 20.05 grams. Undisturbed by the skillful treatment, it even seems reluctant to be released. In an average year, Roger and his assistants log something like 200 species and ring over 6,000 birds, a prodigious outlay of time and energy. Excavations at Landberg, a narrow, steep-sided headland within sight of the bird observatory, have provided evidence of a promontory fort dating from the Iron Age. Pieces of pottery have been unearthed, along with stone weights, a lamp, querns, and a series of mortars. Leaving Landberg, you can follow the narrow road which winds northwards and ends at the gate of the North Light, standing above the 75-metre-high screw cliffs. There are lighthouses at the north and south ends of the island, designed by the same Stevenson family as that of Robert Louis Stevenson. They came into full operation in 1892. Three lightkeepers and their families lived at each station and kept a 24-hour watch. In 1982, the North Light was automated. This involved the removal of the original lighting apparatus and the installation of an electrically driven revolving system and battery-operated lamps. Stay in this area for a while, as some of the most spectacular cliff scenery is along the north and west coast. Sheer slabs of bare rock alternate with steep, grassy slopes. Here you can agree with Robert Louis Stevenson's description of the coast of Fair Isle as the wildest and most unpitying that he had ever seen. Around the stacks of screw is a favourite haunt of grey seals, while in summer colonies of gannets whiten the roof of Kirkstack, the outer of the tomb, also known as the cathedral. Before leaving this end of the isle, you can walk up to the top of Ward Hill, which rises 217 metres above the sea. But as you approach its summit, beware of the colonies of Arctic and Great Skuas. They patrol territories covering much of the moorland interior and protect their nests in the breeding season with high-speed, vicious and accurate diving sorties on the unfortunate trespasser. During the Second World War, a radar station was established on top of Ward Hill with a complex of military structures which functioned for the garrisoning and service of the station. To the southeast of the summit, near the modern television mast, you can see what's left of a narrow gauge track and winch, used for the carriage of supply material. extensive military remains still litter the landscape. In 1961, the radar station was reduced to rubble in an attempt to re-establish the natural skyline. On the south side, a set of concrete platforms still bears a rusty stove. The best known military relic still on the isle is the remains of a German Heinkel which crash-landed during a reconnaissance mission in 1941. Part of the wreckage lies in a ditch near the Gilsitter Burn. Three of the plane's crew survived and one, the pilot, revisited the isle in 1987. In the sky, lapwings and curlews shout in annoyance as you walk across their territory, and the repeated piercing scream of an oyster catcher means that you are just too close to its nest. Strolling on, you reach the hill dike which separates the northern unpopulated region of moorland from the lower arable land to the south, the site of main settlement. The tall, dry-stained dike which divides the two regions follows the line of a wide earthen boundary known as the Filly, or Turf, dike, which runs across the isle from coast to coast. The sector to the south of the dike housed a peak record of 380 souls in the mid-19th century, compared to the present population of around 70 inhabitants. Close to the hill dike, on a long, warm day in early July, there may be the chance to join the community and lend a helping hand at the sheep hill. Nearly everyone, from the oldest to the youngest, turns out to caw the hull sheep into the crew. Cawing is the rounding up of the animals. Crew is the enclosure they are driven into, in this case the sheep pen situated at the side of the airstrip turning. Sheep form the backbone of the crofting unit, small and hardy Shetland sheep on the common hill grazing which covers the northern half of the isle, and a mixture of Shetland and crossbreeds, mostly Cheviot and Suffolk, on the in-by land around the houses. Most of the fleeces, rolled up tightly and bagged, are sent out to Shetland to be commercially spun. A short distance from the hill dike lies the airstrip. Built and first used during the Second World War, it has been used since 1967 by Loganair Charter Service and Air Ambulance. The strip was enlarged in the early 1970s and weekly scheduled flights to Shetland Mainland started in 1976. Arctic terns breed nearby on Turriefield. Each year they make the incredible journey from Antarctica to this northern isle. The fearless little birds are always ready to protect their nests against all comers. They stop and hover on their narrow pointed wings, rebuking the intruders and diving on their heads. In 1997, the breeding population reached an all-time record of 1,750 pairs nesting on the island. Now let's see another component of Fair Isle's economy, its famous knitwear. As all the knitting is done in the homes of the members of Fair Isle Crafts, the small cooperative set up to promote the production of traditional Fair Isle knitwear, you have to meet a member of the cooperative, in this case Claire, and take advantage of her kindness. The tradition of patron knitting and its intricate skill have been practiced continuously on Fair Isle for generations. We may never know from which sources the women of this remote isle derived their inspiration. The secret sleeps deep in the island's past, but they have proved to be fitting custodians of this enchanting art, which can still be seen and enjoyed today. Although machine-made, the garments are still individual. The knitter has the freedom to use and interpret the local patterns within her own design. Each article is finished by hand, double-checked, then labelled with the Fair Isle Crafts exclusive trademark. The road winds to the south, and on the left side you can't miss Stackhole Stores, the island shop, now under the management of Fiona and Robert Mitchell. Inside you find all kinds of groceries, frozen food, fresh fruit and vegetables, and a variety of goods such as stationery, hardware and medicines. A short visit to the school building gives you the chance to meet some of the children of the island. Fair Isle Primary School has a pupil roll of 7 at present, 4 girls and 3 boys. This century, the roll reached its peak of 43 pupils in 1900 and has been as low as 1 for a short time on 2 occasions. The school takes a keen interest in environmental issues and for some time has been involved in the recycling of plastics and aluminium cans. Children are encouraged to follow the path that leads to further education on the British mainland, but many, education completed, settle back in Fair Isle. The Fair Isle Times is a local newsletter originated in 1978 as a school magazine and now published by a committee of islanders in conjunction with the school. Further south, there is the Church of Scotland Kirk, which was completed in 1892. There are 2 church buildings. The other one, the Methodist Chapel, is just off the middle road near the museum. It is almost unbelievable that both Methodist and Presbyterian members worship together each Sunday, alternately at one or other of the buildings. A very practical demonstration of tolerance which often surprises visitors. Recently, splendid stained glass windows were gifted to the kirk. Designed and made by Patrick Ross Smith, who lives on the isle, the designs Alpha and Omega are remarkable for their use of local scenes, pebbled stones, cliffs, little boats, lambs, flowers, and above all, a shimmering dove. It's not easy to leave a place which speaks of peace, meditation, and spirituality. Outside, as flowers are everywhere and a delight to the eye, have a closer look at them. The orchids are growing wild and take the spotlight, but you have a choice of more than 240 species flowering through the fields, on the moorland and in the cliffs. The insectivorous round-leafed sundew is one of the 2 carnivorous plants on the local list. It is a happy surprise to see that the ancient art of boat building has been revived after a break of almost 50 years by Ian Best, an islander who went to Norway to learn his craft. The lines of the traditional yole have a distinct Viking origin and at first sight may look inadequate in the face of the fierce swells and treacherous tide races, but with an experienced local boatman at the helm, the yole comes into its own, sliding round invisible underwater ridges and bars and manoeuvring in and out of steep-sided gyos with apparent ease. It is impossible to know how many people have been saved from drowning by islanders who launched their yoles in terrifying conditions, but 465 were rescued in May 1868, when the German ship Lessing was wrecked in Kleverskjö. The passengers and crew were ferried by the yawls to the safety of the beach at Heswells and helped up the cliff path by the island women. In September 1588, El Gran Griffin, an Armada support vessel with its complement of sailors, carrying two companies of soldiers and a small group of priests and Irish volunteers, was wrecked in Strumsheeler. In dire straits from storm damage, an attempt had been made to beach her in Swazio, which the tide thwarted. No lives were lost that day, but 50 men were to die of starvation before rescue on November 14th. In 1984, a delegation of Spaniards dedicated an iron cross in the graveyard to the memory of those who died. The old Presbyterian church stood on this site above Kirkeagh till nearly the end of last century, and its walls are now incorporated into the present boundary. South Harbour was the focus of the isle-based fishing fleet for hundreds of years. All summer long, the yawls fished for haddock, cod and saithe, until powerful trawlers and the lack of a natural harbour put an end to the local competition. As any islander has to tackle a wide range of occupations, here on the road you spot Robert, the island shopkeeper, building a dry stain dike. Not an easy task for a beginner. Being in the south end of the isle, you can pay a visit to the other lighthouse, which, with its 26-metre-high tower, was first lit in January 1892. The South Light is still manned by Northern Lighthouse Board staff, with three lightkeepers on duty and a monthly rota. Like the North Light, the South should be fully automated by 1998, and when the same fate befalls the lighthouse on North Ronaldsay, there will be no manned lighthouses in Scotland or the Isle of Man. On a clear night, the South Light seems to exchange its flashes with the distant light on North Ronaldsay in Orkney, 27 miles away. Much of the island's history is preserved in the George Watherston Centre and Museum. Agricultural and maritime displays, archaeology and natural history, photographs, knitwear, and a reconstructed croft kitchen all offer a glimpse into the past. There's a beautifully made child's cradle and an assortment of domestic items all made from driftwood, the beaches being the only source of wood on the isle. The formal opening of the museum took place on 18th June 1986, when the ceremony was combined with the presentation of the Council of Europe diploma, awarded for the successful integration of the islander's lifestyle with the conservation of its landscape and wildlife. Just near the museum, there is the other church building, the Methodist Chapel. Services are led by the Reverend John Best and supported, from time to time, by a visiting minister from the Shetland Mainland. The chapel, too, has beautiful stained glass windows. Dated 1936, they are decorated with scenes from the Gospel. I look at the old hall where Sir Walter Scott stayed when he visited the isle in August 1814. Then let's go to the top of Malcolm's Head, where you have great views over most of the island and far out to sea. During the Napoleonic Wars in the 19th century, a watchtower was erected on Malcolm's Head, and from there, observers kept a lookout for enemy ships. One of the most exciting places for any bird watcher is a high, sheer rock face thronged with seabirds. But even if you are not so enthusiastic about birds, settle down for a while and gaze across the stupendous mural of cliff scenery stretching to the northeast. Each species has its own niche on the steep slopes. The shags are on the wider ledges or hidden in the recesses of sea caves. The guillemots line up in close ranks on the narrower rock shelves. Higher up, you find the fulmars guarding their single egg or soaring on stiff wings parallel to the cliff face. And on the turf covering the cliff top, puffins excavate burrows or move into those vacated by rabbits. Walking along the west coast and passing the spectacular rock finger known as the Sheriff, you can observe how the process of geoformation works. This cavern brings the tide into southern saltwater Rava, which is still arched over by a narrow rock bridge. When the arch over North Rava fell in 1913, a new geo was formed. After the birds, the cliffs, the rocks. You may want to know more about the people. Don't be surprised to find a young islander making perfect copies of the Kochanski violin. Created in 1741 by a famous Italian fiddle maker, Ewan Thompson learnt his craft in England, where he attended a three-year course to get his diploma. Now he is back, and with his wife Emma, is raising a family where his roots are. Another islander, Michael Stout, is making replicas of the Fair Isle boats used for fishing over the centuries. His father, Alec, began making model yawls after he became disabled. And Michael thinks this is something that might appeal to visitors and souvenir hunters looking for an alternative to knitwear. The weather conditions affect many aspects of island life, so you can understand what it means to have three trained meteorologists on the island. One of them is Dave Wheeler, who came to live on Fair Isle in 1972 with his wife Jane to run a small croft. Dave took over the weather station already based on the isle and now makes round-the-clock weather observations and processes data for inclusion in national and international weather forecasts broadcast from the Met Office at Bracknell. Your journey is nearly at an end, and you know you have to make the most of the remaining time. Strolling the length of the island, your attention is drawn to Pund, a cluster of ruins now standing empty and deserted. One of the most famous of Fair Isle's visitors early this century, the Duchess of Bedford, arrived several times on her private yacht, the Sapphire. She rented Pund as her holiday home and renamed it Orthelon Cottage. Now your attention is drawn to the plight of the lambs. They don't appreciate that this treatment is good for them. Near the old barn in Kellet Shirva, watching the school children collect rubbish, you learn that once a year in the spring, it's a Vor Raid-up day. Vor for spring and Raid-up for clear-up. The whole community takes part in the removal of unsightly rubbish, mainly plastics, bottles, bags and cans, which gather in the ditches, blow onto the fences and wash up on the beaches. Enjoy one more sunset over Malcolm's Head, or go to where the road ends at the North Light when the sun barely slips below the horizon in the northwest sky. There is a great sight. North Light stands empty, its family's gone, but the light still beams out over the grey sea. The day to leave has come. Fog and clouds have only delayed the plane, but the pilot has found a gap in the clouds and you must hurry to the airstrip. You feel revived by this journey, and can understand why George Watherston fell in love with the island and its people. Here there's not only birds and spectacular scenery, but a harmony between man and nature not easily found elsewhere. And if you spend a moment considering what the future holds for Fair Isle, just think of the children. Like their parents, they will take good care of this unforgettable island.